Bene, grazie per essere qui. Sappiamo che altra gente sta arrivando, ma è importante che le persone, poche o molte che siano, siano interessate all'argomento, che è un argomento un po' particolare da trattare all'interno del Parlamento europeo. Io vengo da una storia personale, diciamo, particolare, nel senso che in qualche modo è legata all'argomento di cui trattiamo oggi, perché per 15 anni, prima di lavorare al Parlamento europeo, ero responsabile scientifico di una piccola NGO che si chiama Fondazione Cetacea, quindi aveva a che fare con i cetacei, e oggi parliamo di un tema che ha a che fare con una specie in particolare di cetacei, che sono le pilot whale, quindi le orbici di fondo italiane. Durante la mia storia professionale mi è capitato molte volte di sentire parlare di questa pratica di cui parliamo oggi, e ovviamente e normalmente ne ho sentito parlare in maniera molto molto negativa, come una pratica, una tradizione assolutamente da fermare, come qualcosa di inumano, di qualcosa che va oltre la morale, che va oltre l'etica. E mi ricordo una volta, diversi anni fa, in cui avevo scritto qualcosa a riguardo, appunto essendo molto molto critico verso questo tipo di pratica, e un'amica biologa come me mi aveva scritto per email dicendo guarda che io posso anche condividere quello che dici, ma non conosci tutta la verità, ci sono degli altri elementi che devono essere considerati. E già allora, e poi lo riprenderò anche dopo, lei mi disse: le cose non sono né tutto bianche o tutte nere, a volte ci sono dei grigi in mezzo. Quando sono arrivato al Parlamento europeo, io lavoro in commissione ambiente e lavoro in commissione pesca, quindi in qualche modo le due commissioni che sono anche collegate, anche se in maniera non così stretta, però che sono collegate all'argomento di questa giornata. E mi è capitato diverse volte, in mezzo alle tante richieste di aiuto, collaborazione o di intervento che arrivano normalmente ai deputati del Parlamento europeo, mi è capitato di ricevere mail o messaggi che chiedevano appunto un intervento, fate qualcosa per questa pratica che si svolge alle Faroe. Nonostante di fatto le Faroe non siano all'interno dell'Unione Europea, quindi questo già di per sé limitando di molto il tipo di intervento che noi possiamo fare. E poi, fra le tante email che ci arrivano, hanno cominciato ad arrivare delle email cadenzate settimanalmente, erano in tutto 6 email, di una per ogni settimana, ed erano scritte in maniera molto approfondita, ogni volta trattando un tema diverso ma sempre legato a questa tradizione, a questa pratica. E l'approccio era, sebbene diciamo in qualche modo evidentemente contrario al tipo di pratica di cui parliamo, di cui andremo a parlare tra poco, l'approccio era molto più, come dire, mi viene da dire più tranquillo e rilassato rispetto al solito, perché ovviamente spesso ricevo email del tipo assolutamente dovete fermare, dovete fare qualcosa, intervenite, eccetera eccetera. Mi è piaciuto questo approccio, queste 6 email le ho messe insieme a formare un dossier che ho con me, che mi sono portato dietro per diverso tempo, pensando poi che effettivamente qualcosa si poteva fare. E così ho contattato queste persone che sono qui oggi, a parte che al tavolo con noi ci sono anche le due colleghe, posso chiamare colleghe, che sono sedute adesso nel pubblico, e con le quali abbiamo pensato di costruire questo evento proprio con l'intento che vedete scritto nel sottotitolo, cioè Both Sides of the Story, cioè raccontare tutte e due le visioni. Ci tenevo che a raccontare queste due visioni differenti fossero delle persone proprio delle isole Faroe, in modo che in qualche modo fossero coinvolte, cioè che venissero da lì, che ci raccontassero esattamente il modo in cui viene vista questa pratica, pur avendo due visioni differenti. E così abbiamo costruito questo evento proprio con interventi, diciamo, poco numerosi. Di solito queste giornate sono lunghe, con interventi con molti speaker. Invece abbiamo soltanto due speaker principali che sono annidati e che rappresentano, come dicevo, in qualche modo le due parti della storia. E prima di tutto lascerò un attimo la parola anche a Anne, che racconta anche lei in che modo il percorso con cui abbiamo costruito, diciamo, prima la nostra collaborazione e poi anche la giornata a cui oggi state partecipando. E io poi darò la parola ovviamente ai relatori e lascerò che all'inizio delle loro presentazioni si presentino da soli, quindi non sto neanche a raccontarvi esattamente chi sono, cosa fanno e perché hanno quel tipo di posizione. L'idea è proprio quella di farvi una presentazione di due posizioni diverse, dimostrarvele così come sono, ognuno con le proprie argomentazioni che io non conosco, non ho chiesto prima di cosa avrebbero parlato e l'approccio che avrebbero tenuto, lo ascolto oggi come voi. E poi alla fine ovviamente lasceremo lo spazio al dibattito e al confronto nel caso ci siano domande o comunque interventi che dal pubblico vorrete proporci. E a questo punto, prima di dare la parola ai due relatori principali, lascio la parola a Anne, anche lei, per una breve presentazione. Grazie.
Hi. Okay, I mean, I don't really have a great amount to say about this. Obviously, the two people who are most important speaking here are Mimi and Hans. I just wanted to say thanks to Marco and Ricardo for making this possible, and to Rooney and Hans for taking the time to come here. For any of you who don't know us, I think it's useful for you to see the path that we've taken over the years since we got interested in whaling in the Faroe Islands, and to state, you know, our standpoint and how we arrived currently at our ethos now. So through living this subject day in, day out for about 4 years, our approach and ethos has changed greatly from when we first started out. When I first heard about whaling in the Faroe Islands, it was over social media, and of course I was shocked by the pictures that I saw, and it seemed unreal to me that a nation so geographically close to me was still practicing whaling. So I joined a few social media groups to find out more, and what I found there was the majority of people were venting anger and hate, and I found this quite disturbing, and I decided that I wanted to have a deeper understanding of the whole situation. So this is when I started at the group alongside my colleague Jutta, Matthew and Gina, and we decided right from the beginning that we wanted to run a forum where every standpoint was covered. And we heavily moderate our group, and while we do give some room for emotions, we never allow hate to go on unchecked. And when we started out a few years ago, we were considering, you know, what action could we take? And we put many hours of research into the Faroe's main export, which of course is fisheries. We ran some Twitter events asking businesses to consider whether they really wanted to buy Faroese salmon, and we ran a survey at Wellfest to find out if people would still buy Faroese salmon if they knew about the hunting of pilot whales. So as we moved forward, we realised that attempting to force change in this way was counterproductive. To effectively try and hurt the people who hold any possible change in their hands seems a little crazy now, and so we immediately dropped this action. And we believe this is one of our strengths as a team. Even though we put many of months into the research and creating events and writing to supermarkets, we simply dropped it when we realised that it was not a good way forward. So we always try and look at issues with a flexible mind, and we're never scared to admit if an action was wrong and to change our ethos accordingly. So as we moved on, we attracted more and more Faroese members, and we found ourselves building really close friendships, regardless of whether these people were pro or anti-whaling. And sometimes it feels like the first hurdle is combating the hate across social media. But we now have a strong core of people who see that friendship and dialogue is possible, and this core is growing all the time. The license to hate that is perpetuated across social media with wording such as the ferocious isles, bloodthirsty barbarians, whale murderers, and headlines such as a Faroese local smiles while covered in the blood of a slaughtered pilot whale. This kind of reporting encourages some truly disgraceful commenting by followers of these groups. Comments we see regularly are mercury-ridden psychopaths, child molesters, wishing death upon the people of the Faroe Islands. These are all commonplace. And we have never seen any attempt from other moderators to correct this kind of abusive language. For moderators of a group not to correct these comments gives a green light to their followers and encourages anger. And this kind of behaviour does nothing to help the situation. In fact, we believe that it is only prolonging whaling. People dig their heels in and become more resistant to any change that's being demanded by them by outside people. To voice our independent thinking on social media for us is also not easy sometimes. We've also been subject of attack from anti-whalers who have accused us of enabling whaling or even flirting with whalers. Yeah. In many ways it almost feels like a crime to be an independent thinker and to question the forced change tactics used by other people. And we found that much of the work in our group is to try and educate our members to look deeper into the issues rather than just blindly shouting in anger. And some of our biggest victories are seeing some of our members come into the group quite angry, but after a time seeing them change their hearts and minds to a more balanced approach. This does not mean that people should change their stance of being anti-whaling, but they are now able to discuss and debate in a rational way, which is building bridges and close friendships. And importantly, the way we work peacefully has changed attitudes in Faroe too. We have Faroese people willing to converse in our forum because of the ethos behind the group. We are always factual, we moderate the group well, and we have a deep understanding of all the related issues. There is a question which we have asked many times of our members who are pro-force change. What is force change and direct action accomplishing? And how do you think this kind of action will bring an end to whaling in the Faroe Islands? And so far, no one has been able to answer this question. And to carry on with an action with no idea about how it may affect your target and to have no clear thought on how it might work seems ludicrous. While forced change action can be a powerful tool in some instances, such as bullfighting in Spain, where you have the majority of the nation behind you, but you cannot apply the same kind of action to every situation, and it seems short-sighted to believe that one kind of action fits all. Our group, when not dealing with the issues of hate, we have a different approach. We talk about the biology and the lives of cetaceans, their family bonds, their intelligence, the toxicity of meat, and of course the method of kill. Not so long ago, Gina put together a very comprehensive document in regard to how cetaceans feel pain, with input from marine biologists worldwide, including input from a Faroese marine biologist too. Gina went to London some months ago and met with the Faroese representation in the Danish embassy. The gentleman she met asked if he could have a copy of the document that he could pass on to Faroese scientists. So far we haven't had any response back, but we do hope for further communication. And lastly, Jutta, my colleague Jutta, has visited Faroe Islands twice this year. On her second visit, she was interviewed by Faroe Islands podcast about her stance and what our group does. And it's been so valuable at last to have one of our members visit the Faroe Islands. So please do feel free to ask her any questions later on. I just hope this meeting will be a good way of building bridges and friendships, and that we can hear both sides of the issues, and it will result in a really good Q&A session at the end. Thank you.
I'm getting clapping around. So I think now it is clear why I say that they have a real different approach to the problem. And now it's time to hear our main speaker. I think the first one is Mr. Rooney. As I said before, I'm asking you to present yourself and then go on with your presentation.
Next slide, please. So my name is Rooney Nielsen, and I am a food science and food safety consultant, and I'm also air sales manager for food diagnostics in the North Atlantic. That means Faroe Islands, Greenland, and Iceland. And I also work as an advisor for the fishery industry in Denmark, and also for the food industry in Sweden, and lastly added also Finland, and then I also have a lot of other locations around the world. So what I work with daily is food safety, and that is also my approach, my direct approach into this world of the discussion between should the Faroe Islands keep on or should we stop pilot work. Next slide, please. I try always to promote three reasons for the stopping, three sensible reasons for stopping the pilot well hunt in the Faroe Islands. Next, please. First is the contamination of the food source. It's a highly contaminated food source with mercury, PCBs, PFCs, and other persistent organic pollutants, short for POPs, POPs. Second reason is the cruelty issue, that the killing method is tangent to severe animal cruelty. It's almost impossible to conduct an efficient and safe killing every time due to the uncontrollable elements, uncontrollable circumstances such as weather, slope of the beach, experience of the hunters, and also the size of the pots of pilot whales. Next, please. And the third reason is the conservation issue. What is the status of the population of the North Atlantic long-finned pilot whale? It is virtually unknown. It's really difficult to estimate the effect when you eradicate entire pots of pilot whales during the hunts. And how does this affect the gene pool? The population is probably not endangered by the hunt itself, but it would be really interesting to see the effect of this. The raised concern, how is this that you take whole pots out, how is this affecting the population? Does it do any change? But reason number one, the contamination, that is by far the biggest concern, and that is by far that has the biggest impact both on humans and on the animals. So it is. I believe that this is the strongest argument for consuming this food source. Next, immune. One of the reasons is that you have some sort of immune deficiency. You can see that autoimmune diseases are twice as common in the Faroe Islands as it is in the countries that we usually compare ourselves to, And here we're talking about arthritis, Crohn's, and colitis ulcerosis. And further on, we see that studies also show that the vaccines are less effective on people that have been consuming whale meats. This affects the ability of the immune system to produce antibodies. And this is compared to a control group who are not exposed to this consumption of this contaminated food source. If you want to the scientific source material, you are more than welcome to contact me. I have my contact details in the end of this presentation. Next, please. And if we go on with the complications of the contamination, there are also other countless complications bound with the consumption. Briefly mention a few, there's a reduction in motoric skills, there's a reduction in cognitive skills of the control group that has been checked. And the research that has been done here is like 25 to 30 years over this time, and there have been more than 2,000 participants in this of Faroese in these controls. So next, please. So there's this discussion. The most important discussion is the food contamination in general, and that's the greatest reason for this is environmental pollution. If it's intentional, circumstantial, or accidental. So I understand that we have like a question Q&A session afterwards. So I just make this really really short so we can. And here's my contact, it's been a bit blurred, but here's contact information also directly to the Department of Public Health and Occupational Medicine in Faroes with the leading scientist doing these researches. Next, please. So I just thank you for your attention and I hope for good questions afterwards.
Grazie Runi. Ok, io ho diverse domande, ma direi di lasciarle per la fine, quindi passo direttamente la parola al nostro secondo speaker, Hans Hermansen. Hans Hermansen.
Yes.
So you will present yourself and then you will
be opposite. Thank you very much. Thank you to the organizers for having arranged this and giving us the opportunity to come here to explain a bit about pilot whaling. I and Faroese have been active in whaling for almost 60 years. Started as a very young age, and the reason I'm here is that I've been the chairman of the Faroe Island Pilot Whalers Association from the very beginning in 1993. And I'm still a member of the board of the organization. So what I'm going to do now is show a short footage from the Faroe Islands covering Grindavla, pilot whaling from the very beginning to the end. And just to warn you, there are strong scenes, there are very strong scenes, and there is much blood in some cases. So if there are persons who do not like it, they are just warned. Otherwise, it is just that I don't want to cover or disguise or hide anything. This is what goes on. And after that, I'll explain a bit more about it. Okay? So you are. Thank you. Can I have them? Please. And there's no sound in this, so. Thank you. Thank you. I'm sorry if I upset anybody, but this, I think, is just great. Informed about pilot welling from the very beginning to the end, and that is what actually goes on. So, the Grindelwald in the Faroe Islands, I'm just going to speak.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
The Grindelwald is a very random catch. We do not go out to look for pilot whales in the first place. It is when we are out for fishing or something like that, and then if you spot a school of pilot whales close to land, 2, 3, 4 nautical miles, and then we see the chance to bring them to one of the authorized whaling bays. We've got 23 of them, and it is every time we spot a school of pilot whales, the finder is instructed to contact the local sheriff so we can have a controlled catch. It's been discussed very much whether we have the obligation, whether we have to report to the sheriff, but we have to do it so that we can organize the catch. Otherwise, anyone can go out without our knowing and treat the animals the way we do and bring them to where they want. So that's one reason that we have to report. And we have also, since the organization, the Pilot Whalers Association organization, was founded in 1993, our main object has been to inform about pilot whaling outside of Faroe Islands, but our main object inside of Faroe Islands is to analyze and, wherever possible, to improve the catch, the killing method, so that the animals suffer as little as possible. And that has changed very much since we began in 1993, where we find that we today have a killing method that is fast and as humane as it can be. But when the pilot whales have been drawn to the shore, they are killed instantly or as fast as possible. Normally, it takes 10 minutes to kill about 100 animals, and each individual, when it's perfect, 1 or 2 seconds with a new tool. And after that, they are measured, identified, and then we calculate how much each participant, each boat, or each inhabitant in the area can get. And we measure it in so-called shin, which is an old European standard for shin, which can be in a height. It's about 75 kilograms. And the normal size of a whale is about 6-7 shin, which is about 500 kilograms of meat and blood. And normally the loch is about half for each person. So, according to Faroese legislation, everything has to be removed within 24 hours after the catch. So the carcass that goes out to sea again after catch. So that is what happened. Now, in our organization, the Pilot Whalers Association, we, as I mentioned earlier, we're going to try to inform about pilot whaling, and we also try to improve it where possible. We have 3 criteria which we want to be fulfilled if we are to practice this Grindelwald. The first one is that it must not be an endangered species. My friend Rooney earlier said that we do not know the numbers of whales in the North Atlantic. I do not agree quite with that. But so we have figures or records of how many whales approximately there are in the Northern Atlantic. We also know how much we take out of the stock every year. The second thing is that the killing method should be humane, and we, as I mentioned earlier, if we are trying to draw it and we find that it is hard or difficult to make it more efficient than it is now. I can just add, which I mentioned in my paper here 1 year ago, that the killing of pilot whales is the fastest of any wild animal on land and at sea. And the third thing, which is not least important, is that it goes for consumption. There is an elephant. We would not do it if we were to save a tradition. We do it because we do it for food. And these are three main reasons. There might be other reasons, but I just mentioned one or two of them, but I stick to the others. That it is legal according to Faroese legislation, which is an internal affair, and it is legal. We also would prefer a kind of organic or ecological catch. The animals have been given out in the free and will take care of them when we have the opportunity to do so. So these are the main reasons that we practice pilot whaling. Considering the things about it, it's that I think some critics have been very aggressive and shown pictures, taken out of context, edited, and telling things that do not have any realistic ground, so to speak. But I think in their case, and I don't have to mention names, but in their case it is more or less a kind of having good income, fundraising for their own good. But fortunately there are other organizations that we can have a dialogue with, and that's a good thing. We think a dialogue is good both ways. I, as you may have guessed, a pro Grindr Park person. I like the meat very much, and comparing to what many people say, I hope I'm not too contaminated by eating it, and that the consequence of it won't be too bad. So because the scientists also discussed that. But I can come back to that because my time is limited. But just to go back to the critics of the Faroe Islands and the actions taken against pilot whaling, I think, and I not only think, I know that the actions taken have prolonged the pilot whaling in the Faroe Islands. 1 year ago, there was a questionnaire among young people whether they were in favor of or against pilot whaling. And they were also asked why they were in favor of pilot whaling. All of them were in doubt. They said that after that sign of remotely controlled living in the Faroe Islands made them go back to be in favor of pilot whaling. It's not a question of pilot whaling any longer, it's more a question of having the right to live in your own place, in the outskirts of Europe. And so that's one. So it's much more a question about a big brother watching you than it's a question about pilot whaling. The normal evolution would be that maybe pilot whaling stops because of one of the reasons, pollution, or that people get other goods, it's not necessary and so on, but I think that's an internal affair as long as we do not practice cruelty to animals in any way. So What the actions have, in my point of view, prolonged the pilot well in the Faroe Islands because of it has gone into another question is to control the world. So, and when you go back to what Rune mentioned about pollution, I think that's a very, very interesting question because the whales, as Rune mentioned, have been poisoned by this mercury and ended up PCBs. And where do these things come from? They come from the aquaculture in Europe and other places where they protect the fruits and the vegetables with PCBs. So, actually, the Faroe Islands people in the investigation by Hawaii, the Fairlands head of the investigation there about the Europe mercury, who never have had. Had been beaten up from whales, also are contaminated with heavy metal and PCB. So where does that come from? So I think if other sources of food would be investigated as thoroughly as the whale industry, then I think we'd be shocked to find out what actually goes on. And now that in Denmark and Sweden there have been investigations about foods and bread and vegetables, and there are in about 80% of the examples they found leaves and of PCBs, and the 10-15% over the limit that people should have. So I think we are in a much bigger area of finding out what are we actually eating. But going back to pilot whaling, so I know you can stop and you are free to come with questions afterwards. So what we do is all the time to try to improve, try to make better killing methods. And we have records dating back to 1584 of how many animals have been killed, where they have been killed, the size of the catch and so on, how it has been distributed. I think no other country has those records. And we can also see that the changes in numbers of whales, the late Wilhelm Locke, her records show that it's been a kind of a cyclist where we have a peak period and then 60 years later we have a low period and it goes back. And that can be seen about 300-400 years ago. But I think that's what I want to say first, and then we go back to questions and see what you might want to know more about. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for all of the speakers. Before to give the floor to the questions, I have some consideration and I want to be clear, so I switch back to the Italian. Abbiamo ascoltato due punti di vista diversi che devo dire hanno chiarito alcuni aspetti e almeno per me hanno sollevato invece più domande di quante risposte abbia avuto. Prima di tutto nel primo intervento c'erano diciamo le tre ragioni per cui dovremmo fermare questa pratica e la prima è l'unica, quando si parla proprio di contaminanti, è l'unica che non ha fra chi la propone e chi dovrebbe diciamo in qualche modo riceverla, non ha degli intermediari di tipo etico o di tipo morale. Si sta dicendo state mangiando un cibo contaminato, fate per una ragione e cercate di agire di conseguenza. Quindi qui siamo a un livello che tutto sommato è abbastanza semplice. Ci sono la scienza che ci dice che in questa carne ci sono dei contaminanti e delle persone che si nutrono di questa carne che quindi in qualche modo dovrebbero considerare quello che la scienza dice. Poi c'è la crudeltà del metodo, sulla quale ci sarebbe tanto da dire, perché Noi recentemente in Italia stiamo per riaprire due tonnare, cioè questo metodo tradizionale di mattanza, di uccisione di tonni. La mattanza dei tonni è un tipo di pesca sostenibile, ma ha degli aspetti molto crudeli, e molto crudi e comunque che sollevano degli aspetti etici, anche se in realtà ultimamente, proprio ne parliamo spesso in Commissione Pesca, se ne parla sempre in positivo, non c'è una vera e propria campagna sulla crudeltà delle tonnare. Ovviamente ci sono delle differenze. Le differenze stanno anche nel tipo di animale che stiamo trattando. Un animale intelligente o più intelligente di un altro animale va considerato in maniera diversa. E si diceva che il metodo di uccisione adesso è molto rapido, in 10 minuti vengono uccisi circa 100 valenti più. Intanto il problema non è solo quello, perché nelle prime immagini che abbiamo visto c'erano le imbarcazioni che seguivano i dolicefali veramente dietro, e questi animali sono intelligenti e sono self-conscious, sanno, hanno coscienza di sé, che è qualcosa che c'è in veramente poche specie animali. E quindi quegli animali sanno cosa sta accadendo e sanno cosa sta accadendo. Quindi al di là del metodo di uccisione, cioè della fase finale di questo, c'è una crudeltà in tutto quello che porta poi al momento finale e che va considerata. Dopodiché posso essere d'accordo che il metodo di uccisione è il più rapido possibile. Io mi sono trovato, ho lavorato per molti anni in un gruppo che faceva rescue di delfini spiaggiati, e uno dei problemi che abbiamo avuto è, nel caso questi animali debbano essere uccisi attraverso l'eutanasia, quale metodo utilizziamo? Perché non è assolutamente facile trovare un metodo che non sia cruento. Più l'animale è grande, più è complicato. Io lavoravo con tursiopi che sono 3 metri, ma qui parliamo di dolicefali che sono 6-7 metri, quindi è molto molto diverso. L'ultima cosa, e il terzo motivo, era il motivo della conservazione. E io, quando ho letto e ho affrontato questo problema, devo dire che non mi sono quasi mai posto il problema della conservazione, perché non la ritenevo un problema. I dolicefali, per quanto ne so, non sono una specie particolarmente a rischio di estinzione. Mi stupisce sentire che non sappiamo i numeri di dolicefali in Nord Atlantico, mi stupisce veramente tanto, perché le ricerche ci sono, quindi dovremmo avere questi numeri proprio dal momento in cui noi ne prelediamo una parte per il nostro consumo. Noi in Commissione Pesca lavoriamo sugli stock ittici e continuamente parliamo di numeri dati dagli scienziati, che ci dicono quanto è la biomassa, quanto è la biomassa riproduttiva e quanto ne possiamo prendere di quella biomassa per fare in modo che non abbiamo problemi di conservazione. E se lo facciamo per le specie ittiche, dovremmo essere sicuri che quello che si sta succedendo alle Faroe non abbia le stesse conseguenze che noi temiamo invece per le specie ittiche. Quindi è un argomento che va approfondito, non possiamo dire non ne sappiamo abbastanza, quindi siamo abbastanza tranquilli. Tra l'altro non so se li ha detti, forse mi è sfuggito, ma non ho capito i numeri di cui stiamo parlando, cioè quanti ogni anno in grosso modo sono gli animali che vengono uccisi. E concludo con una domanda, che è la cosa che a questo punto mi è meno chiara di tutte, e cioè se ne farò finissero di cacciare queste balene, che cosa perderebbero? Perderebbero soltanto una tradizione? Perderebbero un'importante fonte di proteine animali? Perderebbero una cultura? Questo è importante perché da lì possiamo capire se veramente siamo vicini a quella che molti ritengono una pratica che deve essere chiusa, o se c'è invece un aspetto più importante da considerare. Perché le tradizioni e le culture sono importanti, ma si possono cambiare. Noi fino a 20 anni fa nei ristoranti italiani si mangiava la carne di delfino, non usciamo. Adesso non si mangia più. È una tradizione che avevamo, che abbiamo perso e che abbiamo volentieri abbandonato, quindi se si tratta di culture, di tradizioni, ovviamente possiamo lavorarci per fare in modo che queste vadano più verso una visione, diciamo, più verso il futuro che non verso il passato. Non so se prima delle domande avete qualcosa da dire su queste considerazioni che ho fatto, e poi lascio veramente lo spazio alle domande.
Yes, thank you, because as I try to put out, we see feather webbing as a whole compared to any animal in the kingdom. So we see the three criteria are, it's an endangered species, but you mentioned don't know the number. We have had sighting service in the North Atlantic, and the numbers have been given up. We've been estimated about 600,000 to 800,000 in the northern Atlantic part, and on the Faroe Islands about 100,000. And we take less than this year, or last year, about 500 individuals. So we go less than 0.5% of the population there. And the reproduction rate is about 8%. So it is not a factor, and we can go back showing records going dating back to 1584, which shows the exact same attitude of pattern. As I mentioned, we would not go on if it were to develop a tradition. Because a tradition doesn't isn't an alibi for going on with things which we cannot stay behind. So we wouldn't do that. And if we lose a source of food, yes, we would lose a kind of source of food, because it used to be about 2 to 4% of our national income in value, which is, I think, that the companies in the union would not let go without trying to find something else. So, altogether, and the main thing is, and there's another one, that the scientists in the Faroe Islands do not agree about what is being said. There are other scientists claiming that all in all, the food from other birds is better than we cannot eat. There are other things in the food, the meat and the blubber, which are good and healthy for us. I could go on to mention like the vitamins, D vitamins. We live in a country which we live in sunlight, so we get the vitamins from. But I'm not going to compare pineapple or to try to make it safe by criticizing anything else. But I just compare, we kill pineapples for the same reasons that any other animal is killed for food. Thank you.
So, and then any question?
I will also comment on the importance of this food source. As Hans mentioned, it used to be a really important food source, but statistics also have shown that the consumption has lowered. It has been less, and this is especially in the demographic group of women in childbearing age, so children and women in childbearing age, and that shows that a lot of the people have actually taken into consideration the warnings, the health warnings by both the food and veterinary authority and also by the Department of Health, of Public Health and Occupational Medicine. So the consumption has been lower, and I think that is a really positive effect of the information that has been distributed from these researchers. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, a few things crossed my mind. Hans Two questions, really. I've never been really that clear on how reliable the Namco tagging of pilot wells and estimating the population. I've never been very confident of this. There is some talk on the IUCN about them. They're not on the endangered list, but they're on the red list because there is some talk about there being subspecies of pilot whales. The other thing is just moving away back to the health aspect of it. You believe that people have other scientists have disproved the study, Hans? You know the contamination study, the mercury by Polway. You said that other scientists have disproved this.
So I won't say that they have disproved this, but they don't agree in a way that it is in all it is better to take the meat than not, because there are so many good things in the meat, in the blood. But that we can take some of it when it's concerning the dimension survey, which utilizes it in a way. But there are many other things which are more dangerous, we know that, and which the PCBs assume much. But that's one thing. And when we come to the number, I myself have been on the vessel doing this sighting surveys some years ago, which we practiced by maybe 50 years. And that's the only way to estimate it. We know how many whales we can abundantly see at this time, when we see them. So we can estimate, but this is only estimations. But I think it's a very dangerous thing to favor some scientists for being reliable and others are not. So we have to use scientists as scientists. So I don't understand why you put a question mark to those who work with the numbers of pilot whales around the Faroe Islands and the North Atlantic, but very open-minded agree when other scientists say anything which may be in favour of what you or other people think, not to be rude in any way.
Of course. No.
So I think that scientists have relied on, and we can, that's the only thing we can do, and we should do that. So I think, honestly, that we should also rely on the numbers there. And actually, the IWC contacts NAMPO to get the scientific information about the whales and pilot whales in the Northern Atlantic. Is that okay?
Yes,
thank you.
Why is it then that the IUCN haven't used the Namco numbers to actually make the data deficiency status clear?
I must admit, I'm not that familiar with the numbers of the IUCN, but I know there are people in the audience here who might answer that question. I don't know if they are allowed to do so. Okay, could you answer that question, please?
Hello. Can I just say a few words of introduction? My name is Kate Sanderson. I'm head of mission of the Faroe Islands here in Brussels. And I'd like to thank you, Mr. Avanti, for the opportunity to be here and listen to this discussion today. We are aware that there's been a lot of interest in this issue in our whale hunt in the Faroe Islands here in the European Parliament. Especially over the last couple of years, we've noted quite a number of questions from different MPs, mainly directed to the Commission. What we do when these questions are raised is we make contact with the MEPs in question. We introduce ourselves, we send information, and we also ask for meetings so that we can sit down and have a discussion. Unfortunately, we have had very few responses to those approaches, but I'm glad that we have this opportunity today to make contact on these issues. I had a couple of points, but just to get back to the specific question at hand, I'm encouraged to hear that that NAMCO has actually been mentioned here today, because I see it's not very often mentioned in some of the material that's circulated by organisations who have a problem with the whale hunt. It is the appropriate international organisation for the management and conservation of whales in the North Atlantic. That's the point of view of the Faroes, and that's the point of view of the other member countries of NAMCO, which are Norway, Iceland and Greenland. Denmark also participates as an observer, as do a number of other international organisations. As far as I know, I don't think NAMCO has a direct communication or exchange with the IUCN, but I do know that there are concerns amongst the NAMCO member countries that the IUCN Red List is an approach that's a species-based approach rather than a stock-based approach. And that's not the way we do marine resource management on the North Atlantic. We don't classify things by species, we do it by stock. And that's the sensible approach to management. So that's where we have some concerns about the way the IUCN classifies things. And of course, we should probably try and enter into a dialogue with that organisation to get that sorted and more clear. But we don't apply the IUCN Red List in our approach to management. We have a scientific committee in NAMCO, the North Atlantic Marine Mammal Commission, which, as Hans Jakob mentions, coordinates regular sighting surveys of cetaceans in the North Atlantic. I think the last one was last year. It's normally 5 or 6 years between these sighting surveys. There was a major assessment done of the pilot whale stock, admittedly quite a long time ago now. It's from 1989, the large assessment, and that abundance estimate was quite large. I think that's been modified since, but what we need to do in NAMCO is to use the data that we've been collecting all these years and get that together and provide a new assessment. I think that's certainly something that the scientific committee has on its agenda to do. It's taking probably a bit longer than it should, but certainly the data is there for the scientists to use to provide an updated estimate. But in the interim, there are no real concerns from the scientific community, and based on the information we have so far, given the level of the catch in the Faroes and the estimates that we have available today based on these sighting surveys. And we also have, as Hans Jakob also mentioned, the long-term statistics. And if you look at the long-term statistics, this is 400 years or more of almost, you know, annual catch records. I don't think there's any other use of wildlife anywhere in the world that is so well documented. And that long-term annual average catch is 800. And it's been like that for 400 years. So you're still able to catch that many whales. So that in itself, it's not enough, but in itself it should be a fairly secure indication that it's a sustainable catch. The catch numbers for the last 10 years, the annual average for the last 10, including this year, is around 530.
Anne mentioned subspecies of pilot whales. Is NAMCO making that distinction in their surveys, their sighting surveys? I mean, presumably if you're taking a stock, we ought to know whether there's subspecies. I mean, is anybody talking to scientists to find out about these subspecies? I don't know.
I don't know what you mean by subspecies. I mean, well, there's a stock of not a long fin pilot whales. It's the same species that we take in the Faroe Islands. I don't know of anybody who's identified a different species.
I think there is some on the IUCN site. I'm sure I read that they mentioned about there being a possibility of subspecies of long-finned pilot whales, such as there is with orca. There's what, 4 or 5 different subspecies of orca, and obviously each has its own genetic speciality that needs to be preserved. And obviously, if there was a subspecies, then this would need to be taken into account. So I think that's why you were asking about it. We're not saying it has been proved, we're just wondering if, you know, there's some awareness about it and whether it's being looked into.
Thank you. It's from Peter Fabry with the FDD group. And just coming back at what you were saying, actually, NAMCO is a certainly a self-established scientific body there's an agreement across countries in the North Atlantic. So it cannot be defined as an international body like IWC, which comes from an international convention. So it's quite bit different in terms of impact. And I would say that I remember well when NAMCO has been heavily involved, that it was not for quite well. That time was for the opening of Norwegian whaling as a body who may eventually produce alternative data or vision with respect to the IWC. The benefit of NAMCO, if we may say so, is that it covers, of course, as even pilot wells, which are not covered by the IWC for its mandate as in other large wells, so it's not small citations. So coming back even to what you were saying, so NAMCO is what it is. It is a respectable scientific body, run by countries that have a traditional activity, if you want, referred to whaling. Just for what IWC does, IUCN, same as IUCN, is an international body. So it is not run by a small group of countries who are directly interested in the trade of wildlife species. You talk about stock. Stock, I would say that is, it's a commercial term, if you want. I would talk about population and subpopulation, if you may. This is not, it's the same, if you mean a part of the species, but stock per se is a commercial term, it is not a scientific term. So when we're talking about population and subpopulation, referring to what you were saying about the long-term tradition of what? Let me just make a step back and say that I do recognize that if the word would have stayed as it was when the practice of whaling or catching seals or catching rhino or elephants or whatever you want would have stayed as it was when those activities were really for subsistence of humans, we won't probably be here to discuss nothing. We probably won't be here at all as a society. And the world would have been much better. So, making it as a standing point, I would say that unfortunately the world has changed, has been impacted severely. So, I don't think that same situation may be referred as it was on the past. Unfortunately, up in the north, you know much better than me, the ecosystems and entire animal populations living there are suffering for, first of all, the most severe impact for climate change. And second, as a consequence of pollutants distillation, is a deconcentration of contaminants coming from us, from country that has developed far away from the nature. So I was wondering whether NAMCO is even considering studying how the pollution, and namely, especially with the impact of endocrine disruptors, is doing on a wildlife population, and how it's going, what are the evidence, or how do you share with the international community?
Thank you for your comments about NAMCO. Just to clarify, from our point of view, not just the Faroe Islands, but the other member countries of NAMCO, we see a regional approach to management of resources in the North Atlantic as a more appropriate approach. That's why we think it's a more appropriate organisation than the IWC. We don't see why we should be negotiating management with countries in the South Pacific who have no stake in the stock. whole population that we use. That's one thing. The other thing is that the NAMCO agreement, it may not be a convention, but it's registered according to the UN Charter as an international organisation. So there's no question about that. When it comes to your question about these other aspects of impacts on marine mammals in the north, in the scientific advice, yes, actually that's when we ask the scientific committee for an assessment of a particular stock of a population. That's always a part of the, usually that's a part of the question. What are other impacts, what environmental impacts can be seen, the effects of climate change, contaminants as well. NAMCO as an organisation has also taken steps to organise a number of fora more internationally on, for example, contaminant levels in marine mammals a few years ago, and also the health issues, looked at, gotten experts together and had workshops and produced publications. So I would urge you just simply to go to the NAMCO website and have a look. Most of their publications are there on the website, and you can see there. Getting to the animal welfare aspects, I think you mentioned the report that you delivered to my colleague in London.
Yes,
I do. I haven't seen that myself, but NAMCO also has a committee on hunting methods, which is a forum for hunters, practitioners, and veterinary experts to get together and discuss the technical aspects of killing marine mammals and looking at best practices. And that's been a very useful forum for getting people together and sharing experience and so on, and expertise. So I would urge you to look at that, and I would also just like to point out, since I still have the floor, that I know that the organisation has approached the EU on a number of occasions to invite commissioners or representatives from the Commission to take part in the annual meetings, and I don't think we've ever really had a response. So that opportunity is always there for the Commission to, or other representatives from the EU system to participate at an NAMCO meeting as an observer to see what's actually being discussed. Thank you.
There are other questions? People who want to say something?
Yes. Talking about the report that we compiled, just to explain, it was a very casual report born out of a question that came up in our Facebook group. So we didn't intend it, we didn't realise the scope of it. It was very informal, and we approached people that we knew. They were scientists, marine biologists, anybody that had any expertise, but by no means extensive or complete. I was wondering whether we spoke last night, Hans and I, about this report, and I understand that there is a similar report, if you like, and I don't mean to be divisive, from the other side, saying how the Faroese whalers view the process. And I was wondering if there was any way of bringing together both sides to jointly work on a study of every aspect of the Grindadrap, so that we know whether there is animal welfare issues, and so that the report at the end of it can be trusted by either side, because there is a trust issue here. Would there be any legs on that one?
My feeling would be that the best approach to that would be to perhaps think about or have a look at what's been going on in the hunting community, in hunting methods community in NAMCO, because that's really a forum where you have expertise as well as the secretariat who can better assess, you know, what kind of input can come into the mix. And we like to use that forum because it's an international forum. It's not just us assessing ourselves, but it's putting the information out there and having a gathering of minds from different backgrounds to look at that. So, you know, if your input, that might be something that the NAMCO Hunting Methods Committee might you know, you could approach NAMCA, the NAMCA Secretariat, and say, is this something you could bring into the mix? They meet regularly with Faroese participation. So, and there are other small whale hunts in our region. So it's not just, there are reasons to put it into a comparative context as well for the use of others.
Can I just add to that, that the reason why this document came about was that there seemed to be some misinformation by some of the Faroese people that we were talking about in regard to the sensitivity of the skin of pilot whales and where is the point that they feel pain. And this is actually the reason why we did it, because there were those people who believed that the pilot whales have no pain sensors within their skin or the blubber. And so this is why we went after the marine biologists to show that actually the pilot whales have extremely sensitive skin and they certainly do feel pain. And so it was kind of an answer to that, not in a way to hit back, but we want to be factual. And you know, if there are people believing that there is no sensation in the skin, then this needed to be, you know, we felt to be corrected. Still, we have people, even though, because some of the marine biologists that we asked to are also involved in anti-captivity issues. So, like Naomi Rose, who does a lot of work for SeaWorld, and unfortunately, because she has that link of an ARA, immediately her opinions are thrown out because, you know, she's animal rights, therefore she may be saying what suits her. But we feel very much that actually the pain receptors within the skin and within the blubber is just basic biology. So that's how it came about.
Can I just ask, have you presented your material to the chief veterinarian in the Faroes, Justinus Olsen?
Excuse my pronunciation, Akia Hansen.
Yes.
Is that right?
From
the, yes, he said he had sent it to the scientific community. Beyond that, we never heard any more despite chasing. So I don't know whether it was even received or whether it was dismissed. I suppose also, if you look at our report, and as I said, it's very loosely called a report, it's opinions, is being dismissed by Faroese whalers. We equally have a certain amount of concern about NAMCO presenting their point of view, because they represent whaling countries. So this is why I said it's kind of a way of bringing together a lot of maybe independent people. But I think it's reinventing the wheel if we don't use NAMCO. So I agree to a certain extent. Yes, I think it's valid.
I just wanted to comment on that, and I think it goes a little bit to some of what you were saying. You know, I think one of the problems in this general discussion is the polarisation issue.
Yes.
It's not a question of for or against. In the Faroe Islands, in Iceland, in Greenland, in Norway, and many, many other countries, it's a question of having the right to use the resources you have available to you. It's not a question of right or wrong. It's a question of lifestyle. It's a question of food culture. So the idea that the four countries that got together to form an international organization, responsible, democratically elected governments, getting together to form an international organization, set up scientific work that is supposed to be reliable and neutral and scientific, somehow is seen to be some sort of club, a whalers club or something. I mean, you know, I think I would have hoped we had got beyond that level of rhetoric in the discussion, and that we were talking about the serious issues, because you know, it's resources. We use whales for food and seals, and other countries don't. So you know, I think that's a basic fundamental thing you're going to have to accept, that that's a reality and a right. Thank you.
Yes, please. Thank you. And just an additional to Kayla's already, going back to my organisation, we have a saying in the Faroe Islands that luck ingests enough,
we have this, and look, just as I should translate it perhaps, which means that the observer's eye, the eye of the guest is very observant. People, we may practice something and we don't see anything wrong with it. But when we started in Princeton for pilot wedding 30 years ago, we instantly started looking upon it. So it was kind of an eye-opener. And that has come to the result today that the animals are not injured until they are being killed. And as if you notice something, the whales are not in the same way getting lots of blood to the brain like other mammals do. They get the blood supply together with nerves through the spine. There is a spine within the breastbone which keeps the blood and supplies the brain with it. So I don't know whether you saw when the whales were killed with the murder stinger, it immediately, the blood poured out, and we know in other issues that when the blood pressure falls, they are unconscious immediately. So the suffering stops immediately. So that is just a practical way of it, that we do, and that is what we're trying to do all the time.
Just a very quick reply to what you were saying about NAMCO. It's international as a result of a multi-country agreement. IWC is international as a secular body and implementing body of an international convention. So that makes a difference. I don't want to say that it's not recognized as an international agreement, but its scale is pretty much different. Of course, it has been set up by countries with a whaling traditions that were in fact looking to provide alternative scientific data, if you want, with respect to the things provided by the scientific community in the IWC, and I have to say, and you know better than me, have been part of the scientific committee of the IWC, and you know better than me that there are representatives of the scientific community of all the parties, contracted parties, meaning that you have pro-weller, anti-weller, neutral, the IWC Scientific Committee is not a conservation scientific committee. It's a committee where issues are debated and discussed and data analyzed. When it comes to seeing the Japanese Research Center, I think we can think it's a respectable center as well, but nonetheless, is presenting data from a certain point of view. And I'm afraid to say that the science is not that perfect. There are no data, undisputable data. It's very rare that it comes to that. It very much depends how you carry out research. You can easily carry out research to arrive to a certain conclusion since the beginning. You can choose the data. You can group the data. You can do whatever you want with data, showing different results, even from same data. That's the purpose of statistics, in fact. You know, just to mystify the reality, or you organize, but you can even use the organization to mystify. It is a plenty of a room for that. I was just wondering, because on the top of what we were debating about the impact of overall changes which are undergoing, whether I'm not saying that a direct killing is the main cause of possible population crash. What I'm saying is that it comes on top of, unfortunately, indirect threats that come from that sadly are not responsibilities, no, of Faroes, not probably even from Iceland or Norway, if you want, or a very small percentage with respect of our own responsibility. So, but it comes on the top of it. And what it does, in example, when you do a direct killing, we were discussing it yesterday, you can't possibly see in advance and avoid to kill pregnant female at all. You can discriminate a bit between a juvenile and an adult, assuming that it's given that the juvenile is not killed, but I don't think that is the case. But certainly, the direct impact, the direct taking of these animals may impact certain part of the population, which are vital. So of course, if you take a sexually immature, a juvenile, or a female at all, and a pregnant female, the impact on the possible impact on the population is quite different if you take another male. So have you considered eventually to, and of course this is even for you, the questions, to eventually think a way to at least reduce the risk of taking such kind of animal on those particular, say an example, delaying the catching power, avoiding to kill them when they are not recognizable, when a pregnant female is not recognizable, eventually putting in place some practice to keep the juvenile alive, or I don't know whether it would be possible or not, juveniles are very difficult to be kept out from the group. But anyway, any measure you can envisage to reduce that risk at least.
So I don't want to.
Okay.
Also coming to that, we have had some tours around Faroe Islands showing a film about the pilot whale, and there was a suggestion from a group. This is not anything to do with the Whalers Association, but these were active whalers. And they were suggesting to have a part of the year, maybe August and September, and a part of July, where pilot whaling was banned. And this was to reduce the number of pregnant pilot whales, pregnant females being killed. And that this was a suggestion, just a suggestion from the audience, from active whalers. And I think that we could take this in consideration. That would be one way practically to do this, because I do not think that it is any way to do a filter otherwise when the whaling is going on. So that would be really, really hard. So I think that would be worth taking into consideration. Thank you.
There are some other questions or comments? Okay. Then I will.
Hello, I'll just introduce myself. I'm Samantha Goddard from the Born Free Foundation. Just wanted to ask you, Hans, a couple of questions as someone who doesn't know anything about this topic. You were very honest today about what goes on. It was interesting to hear. Did I hear correctly that 8% of the 500 individuals caught this year were reintroduced? Did I hear that wrong? Or?
Charles, what I try to say is that we take less than 0.2% of the total population, and the reproduction rate is 8%. I mean, if you have 100,000 individuals, they get 8,000. Youngsters.
Okay. Oh, so that was the mishearing originally there. And so 100% of the catch, is that for consumption? None are left live and sold on or anything?
That's correct. We take more, the average catch is about 53% of the body weight.
where we take, everything goes to consumption. The only thing is if we have sick individuals or something that has happened, then we do not take. But everything is taken, everything goes to consumption, nothing is left.
Yeah. And you said it's given out to people that are nearby and around, so is it given out for free or is it sold?
Yeah, there is legislation going back. I am so lucky that I am come to an age where I can deny to be a foreman. But when you're under 60, you cannot say that I don't want to be a foreman in there. There are four foremen for every area. And when they do not get any pay for what they are, they just can be ready if there is a catch. Each man gets 1% of the catch, and then there's a sheriff who gets 2%. Then there is for watching, for measuring, and looking after the night and so on. And altogether, we would say that about 10% of the max 10% go for the people who are in the after the catch, and 90% or more go are shared free among people, participants and so on in the area.
So it's shared for people don't have to pay?
No.
We have a lot of information in our group in the files area that covers all the sort of basic, you know, what happens and how is it distributed. We've got masses of information in there, so.
I just wondered if they had to pay, whether they'd be as bothered by having some of it, maybe.
Just to say that we have 5 minutes and then we have to leave the room, so I know that there is another question, so
we'll take just
okay, we will take a question and then we want to share.
Hello, I'm Joseph Coins from the NGO Network for Conservation and Development. My question was related to the science, so you can also reply. On the issue of contaminants that you raised, I will agree with Mr. Hamilton that we need to look at who is behind and not go at the end of the line. So we should follow the polluter must pay. So I'll just end on that there. But I heard a lot on cruelty, and you also rated it in your presentation. So I would just like to ask, and I'm sorry, I don't know your organization, so I don't know on which animals you look at regarding cruelty, because I usually look at whales, but where else do you go into? Do you go into pigs? Do you go into horses? Do you go into fish? Do you go into chicken? Where should I say? I apologize for the wording, but where does our humanity kick in? Because we saw a video where they're killed, although I have to admit I did see also somebody running around with the gun, or how is it called, the pump gun, if I'm not mistaken. It's punching through the, which kills it instantly. And I do know they do the same for horses, but I've seen videos as well. But apart from that, what I want to ask about cruelty is does it start our humanity or where does it end? So if we start talking about that, we start talking about chicken pigs, and like I said, hunting is part of nature, so dolphins eat fish, sharks eat dolphins and whales, so nature is a peaceful place and it does exist. And also another thing that I heard on killing, we should kill, I think it was from you, on whether we should not kill females, pregnant females. Although that from a humane point of view is correct, from a balanced approach, it's not correct, because you, by killing only males, you automatically tip the balance. So scientifically, you shouldn't do that. You should go for a balanced approach.
Yeah.
And so at the end of the day, maybe it's better not to make that humane distinction. And on the red list, you said that you raised, to my knowledge, is out of date. Most species are outdated. I will just give as an example the tuna, the bluefin tuna that is considered as a red list, but according to ICES and the Commission, it is in very good standing position.
Yeah.
thank you for your
presentation. I would just like to say that you said, you know, whales eat fish, you know, tigers eat gazelle, whatever. They're animals, we are humans, you know, we do have a choice, we have, you know, we can farm things, we can do different things. We're not only looking for survival, you know.
Personally, I don't think one animal has any more value than others, and I also disagree with you that we, where does nature stop? We are also an animal. Humanity does not accept us from killing other animals for food, and the choice is maybe not for everybody. The choice is for people who have resources, and a lot, there are still a lot of people around the world who do not have the luxury of choice of choosing what they eat, so they have to make by what is available. You were asking about the cruelty. Thank you for the question. Hans showed a picture or a movie of a really, really efficient killing. And this is killing when it is quote unquote the best. There are also times where conditions make it impossible to kill as efficiently as they did on that particular day. The weather was just perfect. The point is that I'm trying to say here is that there was a manageable size of pod there that was killed that day. There have been examples where the pods are so big, like 200 plus, where the killing is prolonged because of logistical problems. There's not enough space on the beach, and there's not enough personnel to kill efficiently, and the amount of equipment can also vary from beach to beach. So there are many. I did not spot a lot of cruelty there, but as Marco expertly commented, also is that the cruelty is not from the first stab until the last breath or the last death. It's also the chasing that these intelligent animals know that they are being chased, but so does a wild boar or a pig that is about to be slaughtered and has lived his whole life in captivity in cages and so on. That point aside, but I think that there is involved a lot of cruelty. It used to be much worse. It has been the level of cruelty has lowered a lot. The killing here is really swift. I remember from the old days. I've also come from a community where whaling has been practiced. And the thrashing of the whales in the old days, where you used the knife only and did not use the spinal lance as they do today, and also the old spear. They used to be before 85. They used to use a spear also, and the spear was applied in the hunt itself also to make the some of the whales swim a bit faster and more rapid, swim more rigid. So there has happened a lot of changes. And it has been for the better. And I also think that the demand now for education of these, they have to have a license to be able to participate in the whaling, to do the killing. I think that is also a really important step in the right direction, but still things happen and things can go really, really wrong.
So we have to close because, as you can see, there are other people. Thank you to everybody. I think it was a very important moment, and I think also that it's a good beginning of something. We can't stop here. We have to do more, and we have to create some other moments like this one. So thank you to everybody to be here for the interesting discussion.